All right, this is Wendy DuBow again. Now that I have you all excited about what evaluation is and how it can help you, it's time to rein you in already. Actually, this is a guide to practical evaluation. There are all kinds of things that you probably want to know about your program or intervention, and there are all kinds of questions you can ask, data you can collect, and objectives you could have for your work. So much so that it can be tough to know where to start. So that is where we're going to begin. I first want to say that the best time to begin an evaluation is when you're planning your program, not after you're underway, although any time is better than never. You start by thinking about your goals and working backwards. So how will you use your evaluation findings? For instance, is it just for you for program improvement, or will you be sharing them? Will you write a report or give a presentation? Thinking about how you will use your findings can help you hone in on what is need to know versus nice to know. There are typically two time-heavy parts to evaluation, the data collection and the data analysis. How much time can you or someone on your team give to evaluation, given all the other things that need to get done to make your intervention happen? You also want to think ahead. What are some times that you could collect data? It's good to think about this ahead of time so that you can make an application form or a web sign-up page work double duty, for instance, giving you application-related information, but also some background demographics you might need or some baseline data you could use later. What kinds of data will get you closest to what you want to know? It may be that you need observational data. In that case, you might need to videotape your hackathon or train some observers to see how the hackathon group work plays out by gender or race. But to do this, you need to know ahead of time so you can secure enough eyes. And what kinds of data might already exist that you can use? Maybe your department already collects the number and gender identities of students enrolled in all the computing classes. And maybe a neighboring department collects the same information on all the biology classes. In that case, you'd have a built-in comparison data set. Or maybe your department is already conducting an entry survey for all incoming majors, and you just need to see if you can add a question or two about your specific program. It's important that you make the objectives of your intervention clear and specific. Here I'm giving some positive and negative examples to show you what I mean. So one goal could be stated as, faculty will give talks at freshman orientation and enrollment in the CS major will increase. And that does describe maybe what you expect to do and what you hope will happen. But here's a better, more specific version. Four faculty from the CS department will present at all 10 freshman orientation sessions in academic year 2018-19. And then you would go on to specify whom and what the content would be. We'll get into that in a minute. Here's another example. New students will enroll in Intro to CS as a result of our outreach. That may be exactly what you all have hoped to have happen, but here's a better way to talk about it that makes it more measurable. At least 25% of Introduction to CS students will report having attended our freshman orientation session and/or one of our high school outreach events. So the more specific you are, the more measurable it becomes. It's also very important to match the data collection methods to the kind of data you will really need or use. A lot of people automatically think of surveying participants, but that may not be the type of data that will yield the best return for you or answer your evaluation questions. So here's a method statement. We will survey all incoming freshmen using parts A, B, and C of the NCWIT entry survey. And that survey is in the reading materials accompanying this section. And another point I want you to get out of this method statement is that you wouldn't use the entire entry survey. It's way too long. You want to keep your surveys short. We will observe the hackathon using an observation protocol that allows us to look for patterns of student participation. And an important point here is that you want to have specific interactions that everyone is looking at, all your observers, and you want to be systematic. So they'll write it down in an observation protocol and look for the same things at the same intervals. And let's see, I have a third example. We will get enrollment data from institutional research for all intro CS courses at the beginning and at the end of each term. So it's important that you specify. It's also important that you have reasonable outcome expectations. Although this little cutie is adorable, doing outreach to her and her preschool class is not likely to lead to a more diverse set of freshman computing students. The same goes for middle school, frankly, in my opinion. Just practically speaking, you want to make sure that your expected outcomes and therefore what you are measuring match your real time frame. If you do an outreach to seventh graders, the only way you will know if it affected incoming college students is to track those students for 6 years, or list that presentation in a freshman entry survey each year and remember to look at those data 6 years from now. So you just want to match what you're measuring to what's realistic. Finally, I encourage all of you to draw up an evaluation plan. At the very minimum, you will want to identify your activities. Here is just a very quick outline of one. 4 faculty from the CS department will present at all 10 freshman orientation sessions in academic year 2018-2019. 2 different faculty and 2 graduate students will do 4 high school outreach events. So this is all for a recruitment plan that you may have. Outreach content will be revised to reflect research-based approaches. Those are the activities you're going to do. Then you want to have your objectives in there, like we've talked about. At least 25% of intro to CS students will report having attended our freshman orientation session and/or one of our high school outreach events. You want to know how you're going to collect your data, the methods we were just talking about. We will collect enrollment data at the start and end of each term from institutional research. All students in the Intro to CS classes will be surveyed about which programs, talks, outreach they participated in before enrolling. We'll collect these data every term and compare across years, tracking when we make changes in our outreach methods to monitor possible effects. So here your evaluation question is, what impact, if any, did our outreach efforts have on the number and types of students that we have in our Intro to CS classes? Some evaluators put these elements and a few more into what's called a logic model. That term just refers to a way to describe your inputs or activities, your outputs or what happened, and your short and long-term outcomes, in other words, the impact you had. But even if you keep your plan as simple as this sample I've provided, a basic evaluation plan will keep you and your team organized and on the same page. Now, if all of this is too much on your plate, remember, you don't have to conduct your own evaluations. In fact, if you have external funding for your program or intervention, you'll likely need an external evaluator anyway. But at least now, after doing this segment on evaluation, you'll know more about what to expect and how to prepare to work with a professional evaluator. That's it for now. Thanks for your efforts.